to the website, you can play back the video anytime. You see, as I said, please join in the class on time, so that will help us to complete the course on time. So still after a few minutes, some more people will join and they will miss some of the part. So from tomorrow onwards, please note that class will start exactly at 9. Today itself, let us start today as per the schedule. So just I'm scrolling down this running notes. You see, just I started receiving the call saying that I'm not able to log in. So it is an excuse. One second, guys. Okay, so same story, I'm saying some people are saying that not able to log in because they didn't register again. So I'm writing the today's date here, March 19th. Today is the March 19th. Thank you, Shelly. You have to register every day. Every day registration is required to log into the class. That sounds good, Shelly. Now you are able to hear, right? No problem. So every day, please join in class at least 15 minutes prior to the class. Okay, you read registration twice. So no, one time is good enough, Shelly. No need to register two times. Okay, let us discuss what is our today's agenda. Shairi, what happened before 9, you cannot hear anything. Nobody can hear before 9 p.m. So exactly at 9 p.m. only you can be able to hear me. Because class will start at 9, so it is not expected thing to hear before 9. Okay, so many of you have asked me the question, what is the study plan? I am giving you some study plan here. Let me to open a study plan. I will send this study plan to all the people after the class. It is not required to note down the study plan, whatever I am trying to open here. Okay, testing course, effort estimation one. Excel sheet I am opening here. I will send this Excel sheet. So to face the client interview, my recommendation is that to study at least 200 hours as mentioned in this document. As my 200 hours is the minimum time required to face the client interview. So for example, I am saying that I have asked you guys to study SDLC for 8 hours. Okay, SDLC 8 hours. I have studied just 2 hours only for SDLC. I did not study all those things, and I studied QTP just 1 hour, Quality Center 4 hours. So total I have studied around 7 hours so far. 7 hours only I studied, whereas the requirement is that 200 hours. That means 7 hours study only I have completed, whereas 200 hours. Is it make sense to expect the job just by studying a few hours? No, right? So it is not expect, you cannot expect a job without completing your part. Your part is that to study at least 200 hours. There is no guarantee that you will get the job just by studying 200 hours. This is the minimum time required. This is the minimum time you need to spend to face the client interview. Some of you have some incorrect understanding that, testing is very easy. No, testing is not easy. Testing is not so easy, but testing is easy comparatively development. comparatively developers' effort, testers' effort is easy. So you need to study hard to get into the market. If it is very easy, why companies pay you $40 per hour? You know, if I work in Walmart as a billing clerk, I may get around $10 or $12 per hour. Just $12 per hour I will get it. Whereas if I work as a software tester for the same Walmart.com, I will get $40 per hour. Why they pay me more money? Same company, for a tester, they are paying $40, whereas for a billing clerk, it is just $12. Why? Because some more skill set is required to work as a tester, comparatively a billing clerk. So testing, remember, you know, here we are getting more money means they expect more from us. That means we need to work hard. It's not so difficult, but we can do it. Testing is not a rocket science. You know, we can be able to do the software testing job by studying the required topics. So let us learn what topics we need to study. So here the study plan is that DLC 8 hours, black box testing 5 hours, like this. I have given all the topics, and you know, if you follow this one, definitely you can be able to face the client interview. Your question from Aparajita: as a beginner, according to the study plan, I have to study for SQL for 24 hours for basics of the SQL. You are right, Aparajita. You need to spend at least 24 hours study on SQL. You know, again, I just arrived 200 hours. It may not be the correct. You know, there may be some up and downs are there. It will give you overall idea about how much time you need to spend for study. Okay, so at the end of the course, you know, you can do self-assessment. How many hours I studied so far? Okay, 2 hours here I studied, 1 hour only I studied. So I can do self-assessment where I am. I have to study 200 hours, whereas I studied 7 hours only. So no, it won't make sense for me to expect a job and face the client interview. So please plan accordingly and make sure that you complete this study plan. Okay, just we are done with the study plan. So let us get into the actual subject. You know, yesterday we had some just orientation session. Today we will start the actual subject. What kind of job you are expecting? You are expecting a tester job. You are expecting a functionality tester job. You see, functionality, let me to write down that here. You are expecting a software tester job. Or some people say that functionality tester job. Oh, what is functionality testing? Functionality means, you know, is this software is working as per expectation or not? See, what is meant by testing? Let us learn what is meant by testing. Testing means we need to make sure that the requirement is satisfied by the software. So here, let me to write down here, expected result. My expected result and actual result are same or not, I need to check. If expected result and actual result both are same, then it is called as test case is passed. Here Vinita is asking one question, you know, what is the difference between QA tester and QA engineer? In my opinion, both are same, there is no difference. You know, that is just a job title from a different companies. Different companies provide the different job titles. We will discuss that for another 10 minutes, Vinita, about what kind of job titles you can expect as a tester. You know, software tester is one job title. Functionality tester is one job title. I think, are you seeing my notepad? I think due to some reason you are not able to see my notepad. Oh, this is very bad. So actually, I'm trying to type here in my notepad why you are not able to see. Let me check up. There is no network latency till last few minutes. One second, guys. Let it refresh. You know, I typed something here in this my notepad from the last 2-3 minutes. You are not able to see. This is a very rare case. After so many, not so many. I never seen this kind of network delay in the page is not refreshed for more than 2 minutes. This is a major bug in GoToMeeting, GoToTraining. Because of the you are right, and the, you know, yesterday there are new features are introduced in GoToTraining. Here, because of maybe due to that reason, you know, page is frozen. Here, existing functionality is broken. What is the existing functionality? Page must be refreshed quickly. You know, yesterday I was writing on the screen, immediately you are able to see. This is now also, till last few minutes also, you are able to see that refreshed screen immediately. So, is it the expected functionality? You know, page is not refreshed immediately. Is it the expected functionality? No. So that means something went wrong here. So we are testing the GoToTraining software now. Here Anita is saying that Anita is sharing her experience. Today I went to Majors. They changed the software for self-billing. There was a hell of a mess. Everyone wanted help. I was like bad testing. Yeah, you are right, Anita. You know, now you became a professional tester. You know, you started testing the billing systems. You know, just to start learning by observation. Today, this is not refreshed. Okay, let me to do some workaround. Here, page is not getting refreshed. This may be due to more load or server is not working. Server is not properly working. So, let me to do some troubleshoot. I would like to make one of you as the presenter. Okay, I'm. If you don't mind, let me to make Aparajita as the presenter. Sorry, not a presenter. I'm saying that I'm changing the presenter as Aparajita. Aparajita, could you please click on show my screen? Just troubleshooting. If you click on show my screen, I can be able to see your computer. Could you just please click on show my screen? Yes, I am able to see. Quickly refresh. You know, I am coming back to my machine now. Now, currently you guys are able to see Aparajita's machine. Now I came back to my machine. So, still, one second. You know, something went wrong here. Okay. Now still is not you are not able to see this one. It's not a showstopper. Okay. This is one of the major bugs here. You know, actually, I am moving my mouse on notepad. Actually, there is something called dancing mouse you are seeing, right? Actually, I am moving my mouse on the notepad, whereas you guys are able to see on the Excel sheet. Is that right? You are seeing the Excel sheet, but actually I'm typing, I'm moving my mouse on notepad. This is a somewhat interesting bug. Yeah, that is not right. This is some change. Okay, that's fine. I don't know. It's killing our time. Yeah, you are saying that okay, Bharti is asking that, you know, webcam, I'm not able to see. Actually, I did not turn on the webcam today because of some bugs. Actually, I got one email from GoTo training people saying that they have started this new feature. And yeah, now I think, you know, page is refreshed for you. Yeah, now finally page is refreshed, but not able to see my notepad. Actually, I am showing my notepad, but what about Excel sheet? Again, you are seeing the Excel sheet, but no notepad. Okay, let us let me to write the in the Excel sheet itself. I will type the running note in the Excel sheet as a workaround, and I will copy paste this one. Sorry about this one, guys. No, probably, you know, shutting down and powering off is not a good idea here. Okay, now you are seeing the Excel sheet. I'm taking a new sheet here, and at the bottom. I don't know, something we can't see sheet 2. Yeah, you are seeing sheet 2, right? Okay, let me to write down that here, you know. Okay, I know how to do the workarounds. Okay, so here let us discuss this one, and I will copy paste this one. Sorry about this one. So what kind of jobs you can expect? Software tester job, functionality tester job, black box functionality tester job. We will discuss what is going to be black box functionality tester job. First of all, let us see what is going to be a functionality tester. Functionality means, is the software is functioning properly? I have walmart.com software. You know, I am trying to test walmart.com software. Walmart.com is a major software available in the production. Is this software is working good? Is it meeting my expectation? I need to test. You know, what is the objective of the Walmart.com software? Customers of the Walmart are able to purchase the items through online. That is the objective. Is it happening properly? Is the customer is able to add item to the cart? Yes. Are they able to pay the money through online? Yes. Are they able to place the order through online? Yes. Is it working properly? Is it functioning properly? I need to check that as a functionality tester. Is the software is functioning? Yes, I need to check it. For example, if you are a tester for GoTo training, there is a some feature like your pen. This pen functionality, is it working? Yes, it is inbuilt pen available within the GoTo training. Yes, it is working. Is that highlighter is working properly? Yes, it is working great. So what about the spotlight? Yes, spotlight is working. Yes, it is functioning. Yes, it is functioning. Is there anything like something like arrow? Is this arrow is working, functioning? Yes, this is functioning properly. So I need to check whether these kind of things are working properly or not. So because I am testing the functionality of the software, I am called as a functionality tester. So I am a software tester. I am checking the functionality. So I am I am called as a software functionality tester. Some companies also call me as a test engineer or software test engineer. Or some companies call me as a QA engineer. QA engineer or QA tester or QA test engineer. Some people say just QA. So there are so many names are there for a software tester. Here let us see what is meant by black box testing. What is meant by black box functionality tester? Let us see that here. What is meant by black box? Some people say that QA analyst also. QA analyst is another name. Or test analyst, QA analyst, so many names are there. I will copy paste this at the end in my running notes and send it this to all the people. No need to write down this one. We will try to find out the job activities of all the job titles. You know, you will be applying for these job titles. All are same. There is no difference. Let us see, the designations depends on experience, no problem Vinita, you know, they are not depending on the experience. That depends on the company. Some companies give different varieties of the job titles. So if anybody wanted to talk anything, I can unmute your mic. Just please send me chat message. So that I can be able to unmute your mic. Sometimes what happens if I put your all the mics in on conditions, there will be a lot of background noise. We cannot bear that one. So please let me know if you wanted to talk, I can be able to unmute your mic. Particular mic only I can unmute for talking or otherwise please send me chat messages here. What do you mean by black box testing? Let us see this one. Okay, I have some requirement, you know, as per testing explanation, if I need to check whether my expected result and actual result both are same or not. As a part of testing, I need to check what is my expectation and what is the actual I am seeing on the software. If both are same, we can say that test case is passed. Otherwise, we can say that test case is failed. So let me give some requirement here and we will discuss about what is meant by black box testing. Okay, I am scrolling down this one. Today's topic is that black box testing. You all people will work as a black box tester. Let us see what is meant by black box testing. In black box testing, it is not required to see the code, and without seeing the code you have to test the software. You know, black box is a black box word you heard outside of software also. You know, when you are watching the TV or newspaper, sometimes you heard that word, you know, black box. In case of aeroplane crash or some ship crash, you know, that kind of news, you heard this one. To find the reasons for the aeroplane crash, we need to find the black box. Black box is a hard substance. It's a box that a black box is there in the cockpit of the pilot. In the last minute dialogues are recorded in that black box. If we find that black box, yes, we can be able to find out the reason why the aeroplane is crashed. So that means some problem is there, we need to able to debug the problem by opening that box. in aeroplane case to find out the reason for the aeroplane crash, we were opening the box, and inside that box there is a tape recorder. That voice recorder is there. If we play that voice recorder, we will come to know the reason for the aeroplane crash. Similarly, here in software testing, we have a box. This is the box. Inside this box, we have software code. If due to some reason some software is not working, means to know the reasons, to know the reason why the software is not working, we need to open the box. Open the box, see the code. Box opening means it is not exactly the opening of the screws and open the computer. Just open the box to open the code and see what went wrong. As a tester, it is not required to open the box. You need not to see the code. You are least bothered about the code and code logic. Code, what is the language is used to write the software? You don't worry. What is the logic is used for this software? You don't care. You are concerned about the just input and output only. You are concerned about input to this software and output from the software. For example, you are inputting some value like x equal to 2. To the screen, on the screen, you have entered value x equal to 2. Your expectation is that, you know, you should get something like y equal to 4. Assume that your expectation that I should get a value of y equal to 4 as output from the software. This is input to software. This input should produce a value of y equal to 4. That is the expectation. To get this value of y equal to 4, what is the language used by the developer? Is it Java or .NET, C sharp, C language? I don't care. As a black box tester, I am not required to know what is the language used. As a black box tester, it is not my job to know the language is used or the logic. What is the logic behind this one? I need not to know. It is not my job to know it. So the logic may be something like, you know, y equal to x plus x. Is it the logic is used by the developer? Maybe. I don't know. Or y equal to 2x, is it the logic is used? I don't know. Or y equal to x square, is it the logic is used? I don't care. If I am not seeing y equal to 4, I simply open a bug. As a tester, if I am not seeing a value of y equal to 4, say that it is a bug. Okay guys, actually I'm writing here directly on the Excel sheet, not on the notepad, because you are not able to see the notepad. I'm directly writing in Excel sheet. I will copy paste this in Excel notepad later. So as a black box tester, as a tester, no need to see the logic. I don't care about the how the code is organized in this box. What is the language used? C sharp or .NET? I don't know. I am concerned only about what I am seeing on the screen. What I am seeing on the screen, that is only I am concerned. The programmer is doing the background work. Behind the screen, programmer is there. If I am not, due to some reason, I am getting y equal to 6 is the output. If I input x equal to 2, if I enter a value of x equal to 2, I am seeing y equal to 6. Oh, then I open a bug. Oh, no, I have to see y equal to 4 only, not the 6. I simply open a bug and I go home. Then developer opens the box. Developer opens the code and see what went wrong. Developers do some analysis and they try to fix the problem. So black box testing means no need to open the code. Black box testing. No need to open the code. Tester is not bothered about code or code logic, whatever it may be. I don't care. Oh, it's so simple, right? It is easy. So that's why, you know, many people think that, you know, software testing is easy, but it is not like that. You know, we'll see what kind of problems are there in the software testing down the line. We'll see that one. So what techniques are there in the black box testing? We will see that one now. Here Umesh is asking question, how we know x equal to 2 input so that the output should only be y equal to 4? It's a good question, Umesh. Okay, I will explain this. I will answer your question in a few minutes, Umesh. Here I am giving one requirement now. Requirement for Marx calculator. I am trying to develop a software for Marx calculator. Okay, so requirement is given by my client. Okay, I am trying to open one paintbrush. Okay, paintbrush is opening. Oh, you see, I don't understand here. You know, I am able to. You guys are able to see paintbrush, but not the notepad. That is not correct. Okay, let me to erase the drawing. Yeah, luck comes with it, right? Yeah, you are right. So, this is a paintbrush. I'm trying to draw some. Yeah, and actually, there is a functionality enhancement from the GoTo training. Drawings were there, right? Okay, I'm drawing one. Screen here for Marx calculator. Okay, this software purpose is that to calculate what grade is awarded to a student. What is the first grade A, B, C, D? These kind of grades are there, right? You know, here if we enter Marx and click on submit button, it should give me what is the grade obtained by the student. For example, if I enter a marks of 90, okay, the functionality is like this. If I enter 90 and click on submit button, enter 90 and click on submit button, you should say that, you know, grade A is obtained by the student. If I enter something like 10, if I enter 10, you should say that fail. Something like, you know, fail or some value like fail, the student is fail. This kind of messages should come. This is a Marx calculator application. For this, let me to give you some requirement here. Requirement for Marx calculator. Now, if marks are less than 35, say that fail. There is a requirement. Second requirement is that if marks are between 35 to 49, say that grade C is a expected output. Now I am answering to Umesh question. Umesh, if I input 45, if I input 45, what I should expect? If I input 45, how you come to know? Now it's saying that, you know, 45. If I input 45, you are saying that C. How you come to know? Because requirement is there. We need to study. As a tester, I need to study the requirement and I need to test accordingly. If I input 0 marks, I should get fail. You know, software should give me fail. So to give that one, some logic is there. You know, so developers write some code in that software. So that logic, how they documented, I don't care. What is the language or you know logic, we need not worry. I am concerned about requirement. Is this software is meeting the requirement? That's what my question. As a tester, my job is that I need to make sure that my software is meeting the requirement. Okay, now I am writing the third requirement. If marks are between you know 50 to 59, here yeah, you are right, Anita, you know, sorry, 36 to 49. If marks are between 36 to 49, great, yeah, sorry. Sometimes what happens, I make the mistakes, you know, please correct me if I make any mistake. Here I am talking and observing your chat messages and typing here. Multi-tasks I am doing that one. These kind of typos are there sometimes. So please make me... please alert me in case of some typing mistakes are there. Yeah, thirty-five is correct, I guess. 35 is correct. Yeah, sorry, you know, less than 35 fail. Requirement what I no confusion. 35 to 49, grade C. Is there any problem with the logic? Common with the general logic, you know, not the code logic. 35 to 49, grade C, that is correct. No, not 36, 35 is correct. Okay, now if marks are between 50 to 59, say that, okay, 50 to 59, say that it is a grade B. So, like this, we have multiple requirements. Four requirements, you know, there may be some assumptions also. Grade A also we have something. 62, greater than 60, right? Like this, you know, gradient. Now tell me, now I am asking you a question to some of you guys. If I input, please answer my question to all of you guys. If I input some value like 55, if I input, what is the grade I am expecting? Okay, everybody is clear. You know, B is the grade B I should get. 55 means grade B. That's wonderful. Now I am asking you question. Please answer. Some of you guys did not respond to my question. Please respond me to my next question. Everybody, if I input 60, what is my expected result? Please answer to this question. Everybody. Why I am seeing so many different answers? Some people saying that A, some people saying that B, some people saying that B, bug, none, Chetra is saying none, you know. Why we are getting multiple answers here? Because we are testing it in hurry-burry. You know, if enough time is not given for us, if enough time is not given for a developer or tester, it will result into a bug. Actually, here, there is some mistake is there in the requirement. What is the mistake? Some problem in the requirement. It should be greater than or equal to 60. If it is a greater than or equal to 60, that requirement is correct. Due to some reason, business analyst did not write that one. You know, there is a, this normally requirements are documented in a company by a business analyst. By mistake, business analyst did not document it properly. Or enough time is not given to a developer, or enough time is not given to a tester for study and review purpose. So if these kind of things are happened, you know, it will result into a bug. Actually here the problem with 60 only. If I have the 60, then only it is a giving the some kind of bug or error. If it is 61, no problem. 61, 62, 63, no problem. So where is the problem? Exactly at the boundary. Boundary, I have a problem. In general, in the software, we have majority of the bugs are lying at the boundaries. It could be due to miscommunication or improper handling of the code or something else. Whatever may be the reason, we have majority bugs are there in the boundaries. We need to concentrate more time for boundary values testing. So let us discuss about some techniques here for black box testing techniques. There are many techniques are there for black box testing. Boundary value analysis. Second one is that equivalence class partitioning. Third one is that error guessing. And positive testing, negative testing, like this multiple testing techniques are there. Let us see all the techniques one by one. First of all, boundary value analysis. What is the boundary? In boundary value analysis, we need to concentrate on the boundaries. For example, N is the boundary. N is the boundary. Then if there is a case, I need to test with N, N plus 1 and N minus 1 values I need to input and test. Here in this case, what is N? Here N equal to 60. N equal to 60. N plus 1 is 61. N plus 1 is 61, right? N minus 1 is 59. So for every boundary, I need to input three values, three separate values, and I need to ensure that the software is meeting the requirement. If I input 60, what is my expected behavior? And what is the actual behavior? If I input 61, what is expected and what is actual? 59, what is expected and what is actual? I need to check as a software tester. Similarly for this 35. 59 is also boundary. Yeah, I'm coming to that one. And you know, we can eliminate duplicate values, not the minimum and maximum. Here we are talking about the boundaries. 35, 36, and 34 are the boundary values. Similarly for 49, we have boundaries 49, 50, and 48. For every boundary, I need to test with three values. For 50, 50, 51, and 49. And for 59, we have to input the values like 59, 60, and 58. Oh, okay, I need to test this with so many values. Yes, so many values you need to test this software. Not only this, we will be, in the next half an hour, we will learn so many techniques to test this simple calculator. Simple Morse calculator is a very, very simple software I have drawn on the paintbrush. We will see how to test that one, you know, just only one field. just one single field is there in that Marx calculator. Let us see how to test it. Here Madhuri's question, Madhuri is asking one question. In black box testing, if the expected result is wrong, do we need to ask the developer to open the box? No. Expected result and the actual result, both are different. Expected result means how we arrive at the expected result. Expected result is based on the requirement. This is the requirement. Requirement is here. Expected result, we have the requirement. The actual result. What is meant by actual result? At the time of testing, at the software is ready for testing, software is ready for the testing. For example, if I have 70, if I input 70, what is the expected result? If I input 70, what is the expected result? Yeah, right? Assume that now software is ready. Software is ready. I'm testing now. If I get A, that is the actual result. If I get A, that is the actual result. Whatever I am seeing on the screen, at the time of testing the software, whatever I see on the screen, that is the actual result. Expectation is different and actual thing is different. Sometimes, you know, expected result is derived from the requirement. Once again I'm telling, expected result is derived from the requirement. Whereas actual result, at the time of testing, whatever you are seeing on the screen, that is there on the actual result. Okay, great. So let us see here, Swapna is saying that I will test for 0, 100, 101 also. Okay. Now, let me do, as Swapna said, I'm giving you some assumptions. If they both are not matching, it is a bug, Navaneet. You know, that is what testing, you know. Both expected result and the actual result are not matching means it is a defect in the software. If it is a defect, if any defect is there, we need to open a defect. We will discuss about how to open a defect on the software in future classes. I also have some assumptions. Assumptions is that Marx range. What is the Marx range for the software? 0 to 100. That means the minimum marks are 0 and maximum marks are 100. I also have some other assumptions. No negative marks. Okay. This is another assumption. So here in the assumptions I have two boundaries again. What are all the boundaries? For 100, boundaries are 100. 100 plus 101 and 99. These are the boundaries for 100. What are the boundaries for 0? 0 boundaries are 0, 1 and minus 1. Just one value above boundary, one value below the boundary. 0, right? 0. What is the value above this one? 1. What is the value below this one? Minus 1. Actually, negative marks are not allowed, but I need to test with minus 1 also. Minus 1 also I need to test. I will explain you more about this negative number, Navaneet. How to handle that one, I will explain you that in 10 minutes time. Please wait here for another 10 minutes. I will explain that. Shailaja is asking question. Actually, how we will know when to use black box testing? Shailaja, every day you will be doing the black box testing only. Every day when you go to the office, you will start doing the black box testing only. You need not to. What is meant by black box testing? Don't open the code. Don't see the code and test the software. So you are doing the functionality testing every day, right? Every day you are doing the functionality testing. What is functionality testing? Is the software is working good or not? as per the requirement. As per the requirement, software is working good or not, you are testing. So every day you are doing the black box functionality testing. Remember, you are a black box functionality tester. That is your target job. Black box functionality testing you are trying to do. Here question from Shabnam. How do we use boundary value analysis in different domain? Whatever may be the domain, boundary is boundary. If you are doing the tax calculation, you know, here I have given the example for Mars calculator. Instead of that tax calculation, different domain. Tax calculation is different domain. Or go to Walmart, you know, that is e-commerce application. You know, one requirement is like this. One requirement in Walmart is like this. Maximum we can purchase 1,000 items. Okay, 1,000 TVs only I can buy maximum. In the add to cart there is something field is there, right? So let me to open walmart.com and explain you that. Let me to say that www.walmart.com I am opening. Sorry. I have tried to open walmart.com. What is this? Any one of you seen this screen in the past? No. Many people did not see this one. If you are in the United States, you cannot see this one. If you are in Canada, yes, you will see this one. Reason? Based on the IP address, the location, this software identified that, oh, Madhu is trying to open walmart.com. Actually, Madhu is in Canada and trying to open walmart.com. Let me to help Madhu, the user of this software, the user of the walmart.com, let me to help that person and give you a kind of warning or, you know, information here. Are you sure you wanted to open walmart.canada or walmart.com? Walmart.com is meant for United States people, whereas in walmart.ca is meant for Canadians. So it's a kind of help is provided by this software, Walmart software. So it is a user-friendly software. I can say that it is providing the help to the user, so it is a user-friendly. Okay, it's good, you know, based on the IP address, it identified where I am and it is trying to help me here. Okay, that's good. I like this software. Let me click on continue to walmart.com, then it will open the walmart.com software offered for Americans. Okay, great. Here walmart.com website is open. Let me to log in here. I don't want to log in now. Later I will do it. In the electronics items, let me to go to TV and video. It's Samsung. Oh, $698. You know, it's the price is slashed. It is 46 inches. 46 inches. This price is slashed. Click on add to cart, this Samsung TV. Okay, click on continue. Okay, now item will be added to the cart in a couple of seconds. Item is added to the cart. Okay, wonderful. Okay, go to cart and check out. See, quantity update one field is here. Have you observed that, you know, here quantity update some field? Can I update this with 10,000 quantity? Is it possible to update with 10,000 quantity? Okay, let us see. Okay, let me to update with the two, number two. Let us try. I am trying to update with the true number 2 and click on update. Yes, it is updated successfully. Let me to say 2000. Okay, let me to click on update. What happened? Let us see. Oh, it did not update. I entered 2000, it came back to 5. Why? Okay, let us see. Why it is not a, can't I buy 50 TVs? Okay, I have entered 50 and click on update. Again, it trimmed and come back to 5. That means maximum quantity I can buy up to 5 only. There is a message on the left. What is the message? Here quantity is not available. Here quantity is not available. That's why it is saying like this. Assume that quantity is available. Okay, so that means this is a high priced item. That's why it is not allowing me. That's fine, no problem. Let me to remove this item from the cart. I'm saying that zero and update. Let me to go back to shopping again. Let me to select a item where I have a lot of items are available. In the previous example, quantity is not available. Okay, let me to go to movies. Movies and music disc. I think music discs, music series, there must be a lot of discs are available. I'm going to this one, movies disc, like Sophia the First, some music. I'm trying to add to the quantity. You see in the quantity drop down list, why they are showing only maximum 12? Can't I buy more than 12? Okay, fine. I don't know what is the requirement. Okay, because maximum the drop down list is showing 12. Okay, let me select 12 and click on add to cart. Then click on go to cart and check out. You see here 12 is the 12, maximum 12 only it added. Let me to say 120 and see what happens. I'm saying that 120 and click on update. Oh, it is updated. Okay, what about 1200? Click on update. Okay, only 141 only available. So I am trying to purchase the entire store and the entire Walmart, there are 141. So the requirement is like this. User cannot be able to add not more than the quantity available in all the stores. In the United States, you know, Walmart.com has so many warehouses in 3-4 time zones, you know, 3 time zones we have stores are available. So the software will go and check in all the warehouses and find the what is the quantity available. Okay, quantity available is 141 only. Can I buy 140? Inventory back database is linked in this case. So actually 141 is there. Is this software is allowing me to purchase 140? Okay, let me to see a update. 140, yes, it is allowing. What about 141? Click on update. Yes, it is updating. If I say 142, what is the expected result? If I say 142, what is the expected result? It should not allow, right? So click on update. It is not allowing, it is giving me some message. So I need to check my database. As a tester, I need to check what is the quantity available in the database. If the quantity available in the database is 141, I need to test with three values. Exactly boundary value, below the boundary, and above the boundary. here we are trying to do some real time testing on a live application. This is the live application. Walmart.com is a live application, and we are doing this one here on a real time application. So as a tester, I need to open the database and see what is the quantity available in the stores, and we need to test this one. Yeah, you are right, Madhulika. You know, this is a real-time example on boundary value analysis. We need to test with the three values exactly. One value on the boundary, below boundary, and above boundary. Okay, Bharati is asking one question. I will answer your question, Bharati, in a few minutes. Please wait here. You know, private question, you know, if it is a, if the question is useful to everybody, I request you guys to send message to all the entire audience instead of sending me the private questions. Here question from Hema. Would there be any boundary value analysis for login module? Yes, there is boundary value analysis, Hema. You know, we'll discuss that also. I will give you examples for login purpose, how to do the boundary value analysis. For example, I am answering the question to Sam and Divya. Sam and Divya, when I am answering your question, have you seen that some password, can you, you all people are using the ATM card, right? ATM card, how many characters here we need to enter as a password, ATM card? Could you just tell me, anybody? 4 characters minimum, not 1 or 2, right? So that is, the password should contain minimum 4 characters. Password should contain minimum 4 characters. That is the requirement. So what are the boundary values to test this one? What are the boundary values for this password? Input at least 4 characters. Or 3 or 5. 3, 4, 5 are the boundary values. Now you know the answer. So for login purpose, also we can be able to do this one. Not 0, 1, no, just 3, 4, 5. If your requirement is that 4 are the minimum characters, 3, 4, 5 are the boundary values for login purpose. Okay, I'm Bobby is saying that 000, those are all the, there is the input data, test data, Bobby. You are using that is the test data, not the boundary value. What is the difference with test data and boundary values? We'll discuss that now in few minutes. How to perform BA? BA means, what is that, business analysis? Or I don't know, Navneet, what is meant with BA? Or BVA, BVA or BA? Boundary analysis. You know, we'll discuss that more, Navneet, about boundary value analysis. It's good that, you know, you guys have many questions. We are in a good tempo now. Let us learn more about how to test the live or real applications with boundary value analysis. Please wait for my explanation for at least another half an hour. We lost at least 5 minutes in the beginning of the class. I will take some extra time for to cover this boundary value analysis. So we learned that here in boundary value analysis, we need to test with three values. Exactly boundary value, above boundary, and below boundary. Okay, great. Let us go to the equivalence class partitioning. What is meant by equivalence class partitioning? After explaining all those things, I will come back to your questions. Equivalence class partitioning. You know, the explanation, whatever I provide you here for equivalence class partitioning, may be different from many others. Different others explain equivalence class partitioning in different styles. So let us follow some industry leaders. You know, nice to follow some standard books instead of blindly following the material available in the internet. Other to other, this equivalence class partitioning explanation is different, but however, let us try to understand the concept here about equivalence class partitioning. You know, I will explain equivalence class partitioning in my style, and I will also explain the equivalence class partitioning as per different others. However, whatever may be the case, our goal is that to deliver the best quality software. In equivalence class partitioning, we have to classify the test data in different classes. What is test data? Okay, let me do here some new term I have used. What is test data? If you are inputting something through keyboard or mouse, that is called test data. Test data means the user input through keyboard or mouse. That is called as test data. Okay, here in this mark calculator, as a user, I am the user of mark calculator, I can enter some value like 70. Through keyboard I have entered test data of 70. Okay, that's fine. So I can enter 70 is a number. 70 is a number. So in this case, the test data is like, you know, I say that numbers class, I need to pick one value as a sample and I have to test. For example, 70. From each and every class, I need to pick a sample and test the software. There are so many samples are there. From numbers class, I need to pick some value. Similarly, decimals class, I need to pick some value. If I enter 70.50, oh, decimals, what happens? You know, 70.50, if I enter, what is the expected behavior? If I enter 70.50, I don't know. Let me to ask my business analyst. You know, if I have any question in my company, I need to contact my business analyst. Who is the business analyst? Business analyst is a liaison person between software team and the client. Business analyst is a liaison person between client and software team. You know, actually business analyst is the person who is responsible for gathering the requirements. Actually, business analyst gather the requirement and convert those functional requirements into the technical requirements and guide the software team, you know, developers and testers. This business analyst will guide. So if I have any this kind of questions, okay, is this software accept 70.50? I don't know. Let me to ask my business analyst. The business analyst will guide me now. So I called my business analyst. Then business analyst told that, oh, there is some problem in the requirement. I forgot to mention that in the assumptions. Say that up to two decimals are allowed. Some amendment to the requirement. So on my inquiry, business analyst told that, okay Madhu, you can enter up to two decimals. Okay, then I can test it 70.50. So randomly from the, there are so many decimals are there, I have randomly picked two values, and 70.50 I have to test. Okay, in addition to decimals class, what other classes are there? Here Radhika is saying that who will give the assumptions, client or BA? Whatever is given by the client, I don't care. My contact person is BA only, not the client. I'm a tester, I have to contact BA only, not the client. Bharati's question is that, you know, boundary value also include decimal values? Yes, is included. Okay, what about characters class? Okay, user has a keyboard, user can input anything. User, can I input something like seventy. Is this correct? No, it is not correct. Why? Because, you know, is it 70? I don't know. Software cannot read this one. So software cannot read this kind of values. So if I input like this, what is expected behavior? No, characters class or alpha class, both are same. Sorry, let us say that alpha class, you know, as Aparajita said, I am saying that alpha class. 70, no, if I input like this, you should say that please enter numbers only, some message should display. If I enter, like this. Then click on submit button, then you should display message. Please enter numbers only in marks field. Some message should display. That is my expectation. If I get the same message, yes, software is in good quality. Otherwise, no, software is not in good quality. So I need to test the software with alpha class. What about alpha numeric class? What is meant by alpha numeric? It is a combination of both numbers and characters. So let me to say that 70 marks. Oh, 70 marks. No, both are there. No, it's not allowed. If I enter like this, it should say that please enter numbers only in this field. A message should display. Okay, what about the special characters class? Let me to pick some randomly something like that. 70%. I wanted to enter like this. Oh, by mistake user entered like this. Then what is the behavior? You should say that special characters are not allowed in this field. Please enter numbers only, no special characters are allowed. Some message should display on the screen. What about negative numbers? Say if I enter minus 40, is it allowed? Okay, as per assumption, no negative marks are allowed. So we have to say that, you know, if I enter minus value, you should say that negative numbers are not allowed in this field, some kind of message. So here question is that, you know, are all the messages are written in the requirement document? In general, these are all these kind of messages are there in the design document. We'll discuss about what is meant by design document, Sudhamai. We'll discuss in the future classes what is meant by design document. We'll discuss that one. Here Anta is saying, is it not the native testing? Yes, it's the native testing, no doubt, Anta, but we are talking here about the equivalence class partitioning. As a part of equivalence class, but you need to test from each and every sample. From every class, you need to pick the some value and test it. That is called, you know, equivalence class partitioning. Whether it could be positive or negative. Now we'll discuss about what is meant by positive testing and negative testing in few minutes. But whether it is positive or negative, you need to test with each and every class. Hema, you are right. You know, Hema question is that I thought that equivalence class partitioning means classifying the test data. Here in this case, 35 to 49 fall in one class. You are right. As I said, Hema, you know, different authors explains equivalence class partitioning in different styles. I told you that, you know, let me to explain equivalence class partitioning in my style, and later I will explain you as per the another explanation given by different others. So you exactly spotted that one, and we'll discuss that one, your point, Emma. So Navneet is saying that, so every testing has to go with all five testing techniques. Yes, Navneet, everything we need to go with all the five varieties of the testing techniques. So now why we need to test with each and every class? Here I have so many classes are there. You know, any one of you visited a thermal power plant? Back home anytime? You know, to know the, these are all, in thermal power plant we have coal, right? Coal heaps are there in the thermal power plant. To know the coal calorific value, in the thermal power plant, chemist pick coal sample from every heap. You know, from this heap, they pick the coal. From this one, some coal is picked. From this one, coal is picked. From this one, coal is picked. And they try to find out the calorific value of the coal. That means from every lot, some sample should be picked and tested. They won't ignore any of the lot. You know, from every lot, sample should be picked. Here, numbers class, one lot, decimals, one lot, alpha, like this, from every lot, pick at least one item, at least one test data, pick at least one test data from every lot and test the behavior. So here, this is the numbers class, pick one sample, decimals class, pick some test data. Alpha class, pick some test data. Special characters class, pick some test data and test the software. No? So class is nothing but a lot. From each and every lot pick some value and test it. Is it clear here? Okay. Now, another explanation. As per different others, you know, this is clear, and definitely we will learn more examples now in down the line. Yeah, Radhika is saying that null value or blank space, they are all comes under the different classes. They are null values, blank space also you need to test. It's if that comes under the another class. So here, a few minutes ago, Harika said that So 35-49 is one class. Hema said that, you know, pick value from, pick value from one lot. For example, as per this requirement, 0 to 35 is one lot. Okay, 0 to 35 is one lot. 35 to 49 is another lot or class. 50 to 59 is one lot, right, one class. And 60 to 100 is another class. Some others says that, you know, pick one value from, at least one value from every class. Here, in this example, we have four classes are there. Pick at least one value from each class and test it. That is the explanation from different authors. Yeah, as Madhulika said, you know, they are correctly related to the grades. Yeah, as per the grades, you know, we can be able to test in this different explanation. Whatever may be the case, you know, we need to test with every lot, you know, related test data groups. Related test data groups, we need to pick one value and test the software. So Hama is asking, it is positive testing? Okay, let us see what is meant by positive testing and negative testing, you know, because many people are asking this one. Let me to explain what is meant by positive testing and negative testing. You know, I can be able to explain this in 5 minutes. Please wait, you know, here we lost some time, so that's the reason I would like to explain this here. Here I will open one document here for positive testing and negative testing. Please go through this document for 2 minutes. Please go through this for 2 minutes, I will explain. You will not hear anything from my side. For 2 minutes, please go through this one. Okay, let us discuss this one here about positive testing and negative testing. What is meant by positive testing? Positive testing means if you are supplying a valid test data and if you are using the valid test procedure, it is called as a positive testing. Valid, both are valid. Test data is valid, test procedure is valid. Then it is called as a positive test case. Negative means invalid test data or invalid procedure is called as a negative testing. Madhulika is saying that in Walmart we putting invalid and invalid numbers. Yeah, you are right, Madhulika. Valid and invalid also you need to input and test the software. So let us see, you know, one test here. What is the test? Enter marks and click on submit button. In this example, enter marks and click on submit button. Is it valid procedure? Yes, this is valid procedure. 70 is the test data. Test data 70. Is it valid test data? Yes, 70 is the valid test data. So procedure is correct, data is correct. So it is called as a positive test. Both are correct. You know, it is called as a positive test. What is my expectation? For example, my expectation, if I enter 70, grade A I should get. On testing, I got grade A. Then I can say the test case is passed. Why it is passed? Expected result and actual result both are same. You know, pass means, you know, what is meant by pass? If my expected result and actual result are same, then I can say the test case is passed. Otherwise, it is failed. Oh, great. My positive test case is passed. Here in this case, positive test case is passed. Okay, fine. Now let us move to the next line. In the next line, I have valid procedure. Okay, this is valid procedure. 60 is valid. Okay. Procedure is valid and the data is valid. So it is a positive test. Okay, great. Expected value is a grade A, but actually I got grade B. Due to a bug, I got grade B. So test case is failed. Here, positive test case is failed. No, it is not correct. It is not good. If a test case is failed, means software is not in good quality. Test case must pass. Whether it could be positive test case or negative test case. Positive or negative, test case must pass for best quality of the software. No, it's not correct. I have to open a defect here. Here positive test case is failed, I have to open a defect. Okay, let us go to the next line. Enter marks and click on submit button. Yes, positive valid procedure. 110 is invalid data. 110 is invalid because, you know, as per my assumption, marks range is 0 to 100 only. So 110 is invalid. If I enter invalid data, what is the expectation? It should display a message box saying that please enter marks from 0 to 100 only. Some message box should display. Okay, that is the expectation. At the time of testing, I got the same thing. At the time of testing, box is displayed, message box is displayed. Oh, then it is displayed, I have to say the test case is passed. My expectation and actual both are same. Expectation and actual both are same, so test case is passed. Here it is a negative test case. Negative test case is passed. Remember, negative test case also must pass. Some people think that negative test case should fail. No. Negative test case also must pass. Positive and negative test cases must pass for better quality of the software. That's what I noted here. Both positive and negative test cases must pass for best quality of the software. Even if you are doing negatively, you know, incorrectly, test case must pass. When we say that it is passed, if expected result and actual result are same, expected result and actual result are same, then we can say that test case has passed. Okay, let us go to the next one. What is the next one? Don't enter marks. Don't enter marks and click on submit button. Is it valid? Without entering the marks, how I will get the software? How I will get the grade? Don't enter marks. No, this is invalid procedure. If I am not entering the marks, means it is invalid. So it comes under the negative test case. If you supply invalid test data or invalid procedure, it is called as a need to testing. Okay, because don't enter the marks, I am saying that nil, no test data. No test data. If this is the case, I am expecting to get this message. Display message box, please enter marks. That is the expectation, but at the time of testing, no message box is displayed. Oh, then I have to mark it as fail. Native test case is failed here. Not good. Native test case also must pass. Here I have opened a defect. Because it is failed, I have opened a defect, then developer fixed the defect, then I am retesting. Developer fixed it, then I am retesting. When I am retesting, this is the procedure I have used. This is the test data. This is my expectation, and this is my actual result. Oh, displayed the message box. Then it is passed. So negative test cases also must pass as per this explanation. Now it takes some time to digest this positive testing and negative testing difference. What I will do is that I will send this document to all the people by tomorrow morning 7 a.m. Why I need more time? Because I have to upload the video of this class to the website, so it takes some time. At least 2 hours time is required to upload the video to the website. That's why I'm saying that tomorrow morning 7 a.m. I will send the running notes, material, and this video also to all the people. I recommend you guys to play the video and try to study the material also. However, all the material is available in the website. Please, you can check the website. You can check the website for the material. Here, question from Madhulika. What's error guessing? Can we finish it today? You know, Madhulika, you know, many people are already tired. You know, we already exceeded 10:50. It is planned up to 10:15 only. Error guessing explanation need me at least 20 minutes time. Minimum 20 minutes time is required. So we'll discuss that error guessing tomorrow. And let us stop that here. Many people already logged off because of unscheduled time. Okay, guys. Anybody other questions here? That sounds good. I will upload the video, and you can be able to download the material and videos. Here one question from Shailaja. Today I tried to download some videos, but only audio was there. Shailaja, what you have to do is that you need to install the Codex Player software, then it will work great. So Divya, actually Unix. How about Divya? We are moving the Unix every day. We will do that at 8:45 tomorrow, Divya. Okay, is that okay for you? Everybody, you know, who is interested for Unix practical, 8:45 to 9 tomorrow I can show you that one. Today we are already running late. Chitra is saying that no homework for today. Yes, I have the homework for you is that I am giving you homework now. One question from Mustafa. Can I use Office 2005 on Windows 8? No, you cannot use it, Mustafa. Yes, all the people are welcome to join in Unix. Okay, I will cover that load runner also. Here a question from Bharati. How do we do black box testing with strings or characters? We will discuss more about this one, Bharati, in tomorrow's class. I was about to explain something. I forgotten. Yeah, and we'll discuss that load runner very soon. Homework is that Right. I will send this right to everybody. Everybody, I will be sending this document. Homework. Homework requirement. My requirement is like this. Password field accepts minimum four cash and maximum eight cash. Okay. Oh, actually, I need to type that in Excel sheet. Right? Sorry, I am typing in Notepad. I will transfer the all the data into Notepad and I will send you. Sorry about this one. Now, homework is that the requirement is like this. Password field accepts minimum four characters and maximum eight characters. Then think about how to write the positive test cases and negative test cases for this requirement. This is the requirement. Try to write positive test cases and negative test cases in this format. This is the format. In this format, try to write the positive test cases and negative test cases. You know, it is hard to write test cases for first timers. It is not a problem. It is just for a beginning only. In another 2-3 days, you should be able to write the test cases. I will help you with one-on-one reviews also with test cases writing. I will separately schedule the time with you during weekend and help you to write the test cases. It is a one-on-one meeting, not the group meeting. We'll be doing that one. Okay, guys. So this is about homework. Try to write the requirement. Try to write the test cases, positive test cases and the negative test cases in the Excel sheet format. Okay, if you have any questions about how to write the test cases, I will explain you separately. You know, if you go through another 2-3 classes, you will be proficient in writing the test cases. It's not a problem. Okay, guys, anybody any questions? Okay, I'm stopping the recording.